let's move on to our third major topic, existential corner, where we want to talk about Sam Altman's new blog post about a week ago as of recording, titled The Gentle Singularity. So let me maybe include a few quotes here from the post that I thought were most interesting, and then we can react to the general sentiments shared. How about that? The first quote is, "My belief is that we are heading toward a world where intelligence is going to be extremely abundant, and the cost of intelligence and energy, ideas, and the ability to make those ideas happen will fall exponentially. I hope we can transition to a world with a gentle singularity, where the future turns out surprisingly well and the rate of change is manageable by our institutions." Which is an interesting takeaway there. You know, he hopes that the rate of change is manageable and our institutions can keep up. But I mean, evidence to the contrary, just in the last 10 or 15 years, just with the advent of social media and the internet. So I don't know if AI is going to be any better.
Well, here's my takeaway from this, Chris. If you've been on LinkedIn any amount lately, you'll know that people say one of the big tells that text was written by AI is the inclusion of M dashes, those long dashes to break up a sentence. And I noticed that Sam's quote has a couple of M dashes in it, which leads me to the conclusion that Sam Altman didn't write this at all. Sam Altman's dead and has been replaced by an LLM.
All right, now you're just saying shit for the cold open.
M dashes, man. Humans have never written M dashes. What's my actual thought on this? Sure, I think putting the term gentle in front of singularity is kind of hilarious. It's a bit like putting the word gentle in front of nuclear weapon or something. It's like, sure, it doesn't really change. It's still the singularity, which is the acceleration of progress to a point where it's infinite. I don't think humans come out of that well, and calling it gentle doesn't really change that fact.
Yeah, it's like clean coal or something, right? A singularity is going to spaghettify your body and smash you into a million pieces and consume all light and energy. But it's okay. It's going to be gentle.
It's like we're making empathetic nukes.
This is going to be embarrassing for everybody, but my brother is 10 years younger than me, so I sort of like, I was conscious and sort of helping to raise him. And when he was really young, he would try to bend my mother's finger all the way back just to see what would happen. And my mom would say, "Hey, Mitch, you're hurting me." And he would say, "But I'm doing it slowly." And this reminds me of Sam Altman. He's like, we're going to hurt you a lot, but don't worry. We'll be gentle.
And I hear your brother's actually one of the top guys in prison now, doing very well for himself.
He murders people gently. All right. The next insight here is, or the next quote rather, is, "In some big sense, ChatGPT is already more powerful than any human who has ever lived." Look, I'm starting to wonder, you know, in some ways and to some degrees, is Sam's hype getting ahead of the curve? Like, you know, to what degree is he getting ahead of his skis, or is he going to Congress and saying, "You should regulate us. This is the most powerful thing in the history of the world"? To what degree is this just like him hyping up the value of his business and his creation? Because, you know, we've talked multiple times on this show about the limits of these LLMs, including this episode, right? They lack first principles thinking. They lack critical challenging of the audience. They really need a lot of context. They struggle to maintain context windows. Look, if you ask them the exact right question, the exact right way, for the exact right use case, they are amongst the smartest people in the history of the world. And I've believed that, you know, hook, line, and sinker since the beginning. I'm just worried about, like, where is the diminishing returns here? We're starting to experience this uncanny valley. And I'm starting to see the cracks in the cracks in the walls. It seems to me that we're going to need to see some fundamental changes for these things to be truly useful in truly deep, deep, challenging domains where shit can't be just sort of, you know, doing some copywriting.
I think maybe you've swung a little too far there, Chris. I think the technology is pretty amazing and is already very impactful. But yeah, look, the quote's a funny one. In some sense, ChatGPT is already more powerful than any human who has ever lived. Like, you know, in some sense, so is my lawnmower. That thing can cut grass like no man with a machete ever. Now, okay, so I'm being glib. Maybe it's the end of a long episode and I'm being a bit like that. But yeah, it's absolutely true. It has more knowledge. It has more cognitive capacity. It can think faster. It can write faster than any human in history. It's incredible. But it's, you know, I guess what my point is, it's a fairly meaningless statement because computers have had these exceptional powers for a long time. So the question is more, in what sense is it more powerful? And yeah, in some ways, like, here's what I think, which is a slightly different take than what Sam's written, is that ChatGPT is more capable than the median human at most cognitive tasks, which is quite a different statement, but I actually think it's closer to being true, and it has some really interesting implications for how AI gets used and for society, right? I believe that the smartest people, even maybe the smartest 10% of people in any given domain, can probably outthink ChatGPT, outwrite ChatGPT, outcode ChatGPT, outmath ChatGPT. But the 50th percentile of humans in any of those things is much worse at that than ChatGPT. And so when you've got someone who's like above average at everything, but maybe not necessarily exceptional at that many things, what are the uses to which you put that tool? And of course, it is exactly where we see AI really having a huge impact, which is in removing a lot of more menial or entry-level white-collar work. That is something that it is really, really good at. Is it more powerful than any human? Well, depends on your definition.
I think that's a better construction of the concept that he's trying to share. And it's much more, you know, sophisticated and nuanced than he's allowing for in this particular quote.
You know, I'm more sophisticated and nuanced than Sam Altman, motherfuckers. Take that.
Then there you go. And if that quote taken alone is also bullshit. Mm-hmm. Now, related to that quote, he's saying in 2026, we will likely see the arrival of systems that can figure out novel insights. Now, again, there is this tension that I'm experiencing, that I'm feeling in my brain. These things are brilliant. They're the dumbest they're ever going to be right now. They're becoming exponentially better, and it's only a matter of time until all these weaknesses are solved. And on the other hand, I'm feeling like even with 4.0 and 0.3 and 0.3 mini, I am still seeing the limitations of these models in the ways we've discussed. And I'm wondering where this kind of, where this singularity, whether we can cross that singularity, where there is this diminishing returns with more and more and more data, and it never quite gets to the place where we're developing what we hope we can develop, this novel insights or true intuition, where it can read between the lines and solve for the human prompting problem. I'm not saying either of those things are true. I'm saying I'm starting to develop some tension in my mind about those two realities. He's saying 2026, we're going to start seeing arrival of systems that figure out novel insights. And by novel insights, I assume he means new ways about thinking about geopolitics or material science or physics or, you know, healthcare or whatever, power generation, and that we will start to see, you know, some real benefits to humanity beyond productivity gains. And, you know, I'm excited about that possibility. I'm rooting for it, and I hope that's true. Okay, the next insight that he has is that we will see in 2027 the arrival of robots that can do tasks in the real world. I imagine he means, you know, general availability of these robots that can do generally useful tasks in the world, because of course we already see some robots doing tasks in labs and in you know, pilot programs. But he's saying 2027 that'll become commonplace. And then the final insight that I've pulled out here is, perhaps the best path forward, I'm quoting him now, will be something like solve the alignment problem well enough, and then number two, focus on making superintelligence cheap, widely available, and not too concentrated. And I think reading between the lines here, what he's saying is we shouldn't spend forever and a day trying to solve the alignment problem perfectly. We just need to solve it well enough, and then just double down, triple down on superintelligence and making that real, cheap, and widely available. And if I had to bet, it's that attitude that saw some of OpenAI's most high-profile departures, where he's sort of saying, guys, we don't need to solve or spend all our days on alignment. It just has to be good enough, and we just have to keep up with the power of the product. We need to make this product commercially viable, useful, and accelerate towards superintelligence at the same time.
I'm getting really strong Terminator 2 vibes from this whole article, right? Which is like, you know, the whole storyline where they have to blow up that Dyson Corp because they're busy making Terminators. And they're all good people who, you know, just want to build cool tech and probably make a bunch of money doing it. And then they let this uncontained robot intelligence take over the planet. And this is Sam Altman, who has a very strong interest in promoting superintelligence, saying, oh, well, you know, just has to be good enough. And then, you know, we'll put it in all our killer robots, but they'll be pretty aligned. So it'll be fine. Like, it's, I guess what I'd say is these are very self-serving arguments. It doesn't mean that they are wrong, but it's sort of hard, you know, it's hard to differentiate these arguments from, I guess, corporate publicity that is in the interest of OpenAI, which makes me feel that there's a certain amount of, you know, I guess, intellectual compromise in there, that it's not an argument for its own sake. It's more like trying to win a debate than have a really honest intellectual discussion or sort of insight.
Yeah, I think there's a couple of things to note on this from my point of view. Number one, if you realize this was written on his personal site, not on the corporate site, and his personal site is, you know, powered by this thing called Post Haven, I guess, and it's very, very simple. It's not adorned by any, you know, anything very corporate-y. It actually looks a lot like Paul Graham's site, like just almost, I would say, not by accident. And it's this kind of very humble, very stripped down thing, and it's not a corporate blog. It's not an official statement from OpenAI. So it's a very interesting way, as you say, Yaniv, of like laying cognitive track without making it an official statement from the company. And so that, I don't think that's an accident, as you say. I think this is self-serving, and it's definitely at the very least intellectually compromised. I think the most skeptical or most unfair thing you could say about Sam Altman during this journey so far, whether it was calculated or not, you be the judge, is he came out with ChatGPT. It had a ChatGPT moment. It, you know, exploded based on how interesting and novel it was. And then he proceeded to tell the world, tell governments, this is the most powerful, dangerous technology in the history of the world. So much so that you need to pre-regulate it, or you need to start thinking about regulating us. We are now at risk of becoming the masters of the universe and changing the face of society. And that had the benefit of putting Sam and his company at the center of the universe, right? Because he declared it dangerous. And now he's like, chill out, guys. It's all good. I think it's going to be a gentle singularity. And I think we've got this, and we don't have to overthink the alignment problem, and let's race towards superintelligence. And again, I'm not saying this was pre-planned, but the most ungenerous thing you could say is he got all the attention, all the money, all the focus, all the centrality. And then he's like, but don't worry, you can trust me. And I do think this is not a solved problem, and we do need to maintain the a little skepticism, a little fear, and a lot of pragmatism and concern as we go along this journey.
I absolutely agree with that, Chris. It's a fascinating time, but let's not be caught in the thrall of Sam Altman's silky words and come to our own conclusions.
All right, those are our thoughts on Sam Altman's posts and the impending AI apocalypse. Let us know your thoughts down in the comments below. Do you think it's going to be a gentle singularity, or do you think this is corporate doublespeak for don't worry, just trust us? We'll join you down there for a discussion.